the annual Mario Lanza Ball, sponsored by the Mario Lanza Institute and held at a hotel in downtown Philadelphia. Nearly 100 people gather to sit and listen to the Italian-American idol sing on recordings made in the early 50s, and they give out scholarships to young vocalists. But they come every year mostly because they adore Lanza's voice.
It's stupendous. The voice just grabs you.
It's definitely a golden voice, exceptional voice.
It's chilling. If you're here during the ball, you see how it moves you when he sings.
And they love his amazing story. It is a good one. Lanza, a handsome, heart-wrenching tenor, rose from the streets of South Philly to the very heights of Hollywood, then a tragic decline, and a mysterious death while still in his 30s.
There'll be no one but you.
Mario Lanza was born in 1921, the same year as the death of the great operatic superstar Enrico Caruso, says Mark Rotella, author of Amore, the story of Italian-American song.
It was believed in his family and many of the people who lived in his neighborhood that somehow, miraculously, the soul of Caruso, the spirit of Caruso, had been passed along to their son.
With a song in my heart.
Lanza sang right at the intersection of opera and popular song, at a moment when the two forms were not necessarily seen as related. Lanza related them, and his message was heard. When he landed at the Hollywood Bowl in 1947 for a concert, MGM's talent scout brought him in to the boss.
Louis B. Mayer said, "Mario, my boy, I'm going to make you a singing Clark Gable."
Tenor and Lanza fan Richard Leach.
And that's what he did. Next day, he was in the office signing a 7-year movie contract.
He made his debut as tenor movie star in That Midnight Kiss, along with some fellow hyphenates, Jose Iturbi, a pianist movie star, and Catherine Grayson, a soprano movie star.
Oh, no, Johnny. You're going to sing in the opera.
I'm
gonna
what?
They want you, Mr. Turby wants you. They said so.
Lanza played a truck driver who wants to be a singer.
We will be lost in the song.
In the drama, Iturbi discovers him, and Grayson falls for him, naturally. Next was the improbable The Toast of New Orleans. In that one, Lanza played a Cajun Caruso, if you'll pardon the expression, as chandeliers shattered from the power of his high notes. But the movie that resonated with moviegoers and certainly with tenors, that was The Great Caruso, Lanza's dream movie. Lanza had always imagined for himself a life on the opera stage. Now, at least, he got to play an opera star in the movies.
Recitar mentre presso val delirio.
Tenor Richard Leach, who does a Lanza tribute concert from time to time, gives The Great Caruso and Mario Lanza in it credit for his whole career.
It was the fact, I think, that I had had that image of Mario Lanza and the image of The Great Caruso, the film, in my head that let me sort of pursue that. That film did make a great impact on me, as it did with every tenor I've ever met, frankly, from Domingo to Pavarotti to Carreras and beyond. He wanted to bring opera to the movie audience, and he did, and he made it popular.
For a while, Mario Lanza was everywhere. His Time magazine cover appeared in 1951 with the headline Million Dollar Voice. Be My Love sold a historic million copies. The Great Caruso had them lining up for 10 record-breaking weeks at the Radio City Music Hall. And he was a broadcast star, too.
He was on the radio virtually every week, the Mario Lanza Show, every week, singing popular to opera.
And now, in person, Mario Lanza.
But as with any true Hollywood story, Lanza's meteoric rise set him up for a tragic fall. He struggled with his weight throughout his brief career. At one point, the studios reportedly had a scale on the set. They were so determined to watch his every move and every morsel. He'd gain multiple pounds suddenly.
Which he would drop just as easily as he gained the 50 pounds, 60 pounds, he would lose it.
I mean, his weight was up and down. He drank too much. But you also have to put that in the context of how famous he was.
He suffered under the scrutiny of the star system, how every ounce was measured.
How every single note he sang was looked at. It's frightening to think about.
Finally, Hollywood and Mario Lanza parted ways. The ultimate heartbreak? They were so unhappy with his appearance, they put another actor in his place in The Student Prince, but used just Lanza's voice for the musical numbers. He had a brief comeback with some films made in Italy a few years later, and then his mysterious early death, the subject of much speculation.
People to this day don't quite realize that he died at 38. I say it in the concert, and literally, I hear in the audience, this gasp.
Reportedly, Lanza had checked into a sanitarium for help losing weight under medical care. He never came out. There were rumors that the mafia had helped Lanza rise to the top, and he hadn't properly paid them back. So, it was said, they intervened. But there were also simpler explanations, wildly fluctuating weight, alcohol abuse, and so on. For a while, though, he was, as they say, huge.
He actually carved out his own niche in American musical history and lived this existence that you would need to write a Mario Lanza movie to illustrate. That's the way his story went.
A man who was an inspiration to opera stars the world over. And yet he never really was an opera singer. He just played one, if you will, on TV. For WNYC, I'm Sarah Fishkill.